Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So we'll just pray. Father, I just want to thank you so much for today, for bringing us together once again this Sunday. And Lord, we're just thankful that you invite us to this place. You invite us to your presence. And Jesus, we want to come to you just as we are. We want to come to you and worship you with our entire beings, Lord. And we want our spirit to come alive in your presence. We love you. We want to delight your heart. We want to receive all that you want to give us this morning, and we just want to worship you in complete freedom and abandon. Come, Lord Jesus, be enthroned here, dwell in our midst, and have your way. Be pleased, Lord, and be glorified in all that we sing and all that we pray and all that we learn today. In your mighty precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Lamentations 3:19 onward. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. And I thank you, Father, this morning that as we gather together, we come just under this covering of your great love and your great faithfulness. We come with this assurance that you are our portion, that we can hope in you, that we can wait on you in complete confidence of your love, your grace, your mercy, your faithfulness. And we come this morning, maybe some of us in the midst of affliction, bitterness, gall, maybe others just so happy, maybe some out of duty, whatever it is, Lord, just thank you for the covering of your love and your presence with us this morning. Come and do a new work in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Oh, Let's say that with faith again.
Revival will come. The church will awake. His anthem will drown all other refrains. He is our song. He forever reigns.
But God, we thank you for that reassurance and that truth that no matter what this world is going through at the moment, no matter what our country is going through at the moment, revival will come. Everything that is not of you will be shattered. Everything that is not of you will be broken, will be thrown down. And out of that will rise your newness, your refreshing, your move. You will make all things new. Jesus, we thank you that we are a people of hope, because we know you and you are our hope. We lift our praises to you today, our Savior, our Redeemer, our Sanctifier, the love of our hearts, and our coming King. We love and praise you, Jesus, and we pray this in your name today. Amen.
And Jesus, we say, Lord, truly that you are our song, and we say, Lord, that you are our hope. We say, Lord, that our weapons, Lord, in this battle will be a melody and our songs and our worship, Lord. We declare, Lord, just like Joshua and the Israelites worshipped around Jericho and the walls fell down, Lord, that as we worship, Lord, even now walls are falling down, walls between people, walls between you and people, Lord, barriers that have been set up, Lord, between people being able to help each other in this situation. Just every wall, Lord, will fall as we worship this morning, Lord. Truly, you are our song and our weapon is our melody, Lord. In your mighty and beautiful and matchless name, Lord, we sing, we worship, and we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And as we sang that last verse again and again, twice, we repeated it twice at the end, including when Ryan said to do so. I'm sure that there were several who felt a special touch of the Lord at that point, as I did. And I just want to say something. So, and a lot of us are doing the revival devotional, and there have been several times that somebody that he's shared about worship being an integral part of revivals. And there have been many prophetic words, more so in this age, and probably for the last 20, 30 years, the way worship has been building up in a sense within the church. God speaking of a sound being released, and the Bible is full of Psalms also about how praise is a weapon, all of that, just like we sang. And I was reminded of yesterday, there was an Arts Collective. It's an interchurch event, of course. And at any point in time, between 25% to 40% of all the windows were people from Highway. You know? And this is a not just citywide event, it's probably obviously across, now it's across cities and nations, and anybody can come. And we're such a tiny church. As long as we think of ourselves as a tiny church and therefore inconsequential, we will not take hold of and enter into what God wants us to do in our cities, in our nations. We will not. We will be falsely modest about being we're a small church, we're a little house church, and we're very loving and we're very this and that, and we've got a pretty good preacher. Whatever. We'll just be very falsely modest. Instead of saying God has a plan which involves worship, and somehow he's given us an anointing for that, and what are we doing with it? Each one of us. to be released. I mean, yesterday was so nice, and I wish, I don't know whether they ever did it, but I was keeping on hoping. I hope they will spotlight Shanti. But they were busy spotlighting all the glamorous people, Rahil and Prema and Pervin and Rinel, and then horror of horrors, they spotlighted me for a little bit. But I was watching Shanti full on moving, and I just feel God is saying that there's an anointing and it has to be released, and he's given us something in the area of worship. I see Nestion over there, you know, I see Sabina. People are so anointed musically or for movement, worship basically. And I just feel, I want to encourage us to really move out somehow, however God wants us to do it. But do not think of yourselves as a, let's not think of ourselves as a small, tiny church, which I often do. And I realize it's partly because I'm absolved of responsibility for the city and the nation. No, the big churches, New Life should do it. They're a big, huge church. I needn't do very much. I don't have much of a responsibility for my city and my nation because I'm a tiny church. That's all.
Swapna has shared something. I'll just read it.
Sure.
Yeah, Swapna says, reading from Job 41, verse 28 and 29. The arrow cannot make him flee. For him, sling stones are tuned to stubble. Clubs are counted as stubble. He laughs at the rattle of javelins. This reminds us that no matter how strong the enemy tries, he's going to fail, because the one who is fighting for us is greater than all.
Don't know where it comes from. Don't know where.
Holy Spirit, just like you hovered over darkness at creation, just as you poured yourself out at Pentecost, just as you came like fire, like tongues of fire, Lord. We just continue to ask, Holy Spirit, that you blow over this church, that you reign, and Father, that really you would accept our offerings of praise and worship, that you would just really come, Lord, and just like at the altar of Elijah, you would just accept our offering, Lord, and truly, as Dada prayed, this church would be set apart, each one of our lives would be set apart, the work of our hands would be set apart, Lord, all for your glory. Just come, Holy Spirit, and do what only you can do, we pray. In your most precious name. Amen.
Embrace the power of sin and darkness. Continue. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, Lord God, for this privilege. Worshipping you, experiencing your unfailing love, the amazing grace of your unfailing love, that you would take my place, Lord. Just continue to declare that you are worthy of all praise, Lord. Just continue to pray, Lord God, that you will come, Holy Spirit, in greater measure and do your work in each one of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Truly, Jesus, I'm so thankful. We are so thankful for your amazing, amazing grace, Lord. Those tidal waves of your grace that just wash over us, that raise us up to more than we can be, Lord, that brings our chaos back into order, that called us home and made us sons and daughters, Lord. Where would we be, Jesus, without your love, without your amazing grace that chases after us, even when we tend to wander, our feet tend to wander, Lord. Thank you that it's your amazing grace that persists with us and brings us home and reminds us every day about who we are and whose we are, Lord. We just give you all glory, honor, and praise, Lord, because all worship and power and glory belongs to you. Because there is none like you, Lord, and no one has touched our heart like you do. We've searched here, there, and everywhere, and there is no one like you. No one more loving, no one more righteous or kind or compassionate or gentle or powerful, magnificent God you are, Lord. Thank you that your everlasting arms of love are always beneath us and always around us. Our words fall short, Lord, to honor you, Lord. But we do, with the limited vocabulary we have, we do, Jesus. We do just want to say that we love you. We want to say, Holy Spirit, come, feel very welcome here. This time is all about you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. You're so good, so faithful. We pray today, come once again and be our teacher. Open our eyes, Lord. We ask for fresh revelation. In Jesus' name, amen. So today's message, and of course this Sunday is the Sunday before Pentecost. So I thought we'd focus on, of course, Jesus was ascended into heaven 10 days before Pentecost, which would be 3 days ago in that sense, in the timeline. And I thought today what we do is focus on his last words that we see in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John doesn't talk about his ascension, but Matthew, Mark, and Luke all have the last words that he spoke to his disciples before he ascended into heaven. And to pick up one main point from each of those three passages. Okay. So we'll start with Matthew. That's Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. And actually I've sent them to Pervin. She'll put it in the chat. I've taken these passages from the Passion Translation, which is the one that I've been reading this year. And Matthew 28 verses 18 to 20 says, "Then Jesus came close to them and said, 'All authority of the universe has been given to me. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. Now wherever you go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to faithfully follow all that I have commanded you. And never forget that I am with you all the appointed days.'" So Jesus was given authority from his Father, and throughout the Gospels he refers to the fact that he has received authority from the Father, and he now imparts that authority to his disciples, and we know eventually that means to us. Okay. Why does he impart the authority he received from his Father to us? Because he commissions us with the same commission that he received. He received a commission from the Father, and he said, as the Father has sent me, the same commission, so I send you, and therefore we need the same authority. Now the only thing we cannot do that Jesus did is die on the cross for the sins of others. But we can pretty much do everything else, including suffering, including giving our lives, all of that. And so he gives us the same authority, and then he gives us the same commission, and therefore we can look through the gospel and see what all did Jesus do, what did he say he was sent to do, and we have the authority to do the same. And it is a formidable commission. He says, go and disciple the nations. If he had said, go and make disciples, full stop, that's not easy, but that's not so hard. No, when you think, and that's actually become a misunderstanding, that we're being called to make disciples of people. But Jesus says, make disciples of the nations. He says, disciple the nations. And actually, I realize he's actually saying, disciple the nations, baptize the nations, teach the nations. Because nations also means people or groups of people that have gathered together. But whatever it is, it's a formidable commission. No wonder he gives us the authority that he received, which he says is all authority of the universe. And so we look at what he tells his disciples in Matthew. I received authority, I'm giving that to you. I received a commission, similarly I'm sending you just as I was sent. Okay, just as the Father sent me to earth, I am sending you out into the world. And then what is the assurance? In Matthew, the assurance is simply this, I am with you always. The assurance was of his presence. Again, I have three P's today. The first P from Matthew is presence. Okay, the focus here is presence. He gives us this authority, gives us this formidable commission, and the only assurance is my presence. You know, he doesn't say, I am for you, or I will work through you, or I will use you. He says, I will be with you. He just talks about his presence. And the thing that struck me was, he says, and never forget that I am with you. You know, how easily we forget, no? Jesus knows how easily we forget that he is with us. How easily we lose the awareness of his presence. And we think we're all alone, and we think we've abandoned him. And one word is repeated again and again in the last words according to Matthew. And that word is all. Okay, he says, all authority has been given to me. Which means all authority has been given to you and me. What an incredible thought, that all authority of the universe. And I use that word incredible, not the way it's used nowadays. Incredible actually means hard to believe. Cannot believe. Okay, all authority has been given to us. Then he says, go to and make disciples of all nations. And again I said, what an intimidating, and then I for eyes also, by the way, what an intimidating thought. This is what I'm being called to do. At work, and sadly so also in ministry and all that, often people have these goals, you know, you've got to earn so much revenue or make so many calls or whatever it is. Well, this is the goal for you and me, you and I. Go and disciple
all nations. Okay. Dilip will know how that feels, no? That's literally, that's not just his commission from God, that's his work as well. And he knows how awesome the task is, intimidating. The third all is, teach them to faithfully follow all that I have commanded you. All. You know that word, faithfully follow, that word follow also means in Aramaic to guard, like our fortress guards. And I think that word is so important because the word of God, Jesus' commands literally guard a society. And we're seeing all over the world what has happened and what is happening when that protection is gone of following all of Jesus' commands. You know, we see it in Eastern nations that never were Christian in a sense, except for little pockets. But look at it in the West where nations were Christian. And what is happening now, as they have not guarded God's word in terms of following his commands and have gone down different paths. You know that word, that phrase, slippery slope. I don't think it's a slippery slope over there. It's just a dive off a cliff that's happening when we let go of God's commands. So all that I've commanded, his word is indispensable to the commission. And finally, the fourth all is all the appointed days. The assurance is that he will be with us all the appointed days, our virgin say, to the end of the age. Okay? But as I said, he said, I am with you. It's intimacy. The authority is incredible. The commission to all nations is intimidating. His word is indispensable. But what he promises us is intimacy. It's the heart of the matter. His presence. And so as I said, the task is huge, way beyond our ability. But we are assured of his presence, of intimacy, of relationship. Not just being used by him for his kingdom purposes, but him actually being with us. It reminds me of the mornings, what we're doing from Tuesday to Friday mornings. We're doing this series called The Pleasure of His Company. And what we learned first is that God desires the pleasure of our company. And that's what this is saying. And so his last words to the disciples according to Matthew, I think just get distilled down to this word, presence. Okay, let's look at Mark and see what the last words are according to Mark. Mark chapter 16 verses 15 to 18. And he said to them, as you go into all the world, preach openly the wonderful news of the gospel to the entire human race. Whoever believes the good news and is baptized will be saved, and whoever does not believe the good news will be condemned. And these miracle signs will accompany those who believe. They will drive out demons in the power of my name. They will speak in tongues. They will be supernaturally protected from snakes and from drinking anything poisonous. And they will lay hands on the sick and heal them. And so we see a different focus here, but we see some commonalities. For example, preach to the entire human race, baptize or disciple all nations. So we see that there is, of course, a similarity. Okay. Now, authority has to be connected with power. Otherwise, it is of no use. Okay. I was trying to find some definition of both. You know, authority is about being authorized to do something, while power is the ability to do that thing. And so while in Matthew, Jesus' words focus on authority, in Mark, they focus on power. And so that's the second P, presence and power. Okay. Mark's focus firstly is on the actions that will disciple the nations, preaching the gospel. And then people responding as a result. Okay? But his main emphasis is on the demonstration of power. What he calls miracle signs. And again, there's one phrase that is repeated again and again. in Mark, which is they will. They will drive out demons. They will speak in tongues. They will, what is it called? Be protected. Okay. And the fourth one, they will heal the sick. He's talking about the body of Christ. He's talking about the body together. Maybe not every single individual doing everything, but us doing it together. They will do these things. Okay? Not they should do these things. Not they will do these things if XYZ is fulfilled. But he just talks about those who believe. That's you and I. They will drive out demons. Whether it is the specific case of a demon possessed or oppressed person, but also nations, principalities over nations. They will speak in tongues. And we know from 1 Corinthians 12 that, and 13 and 14 that everyone doesn't speak in tongues. So don't feel bad if you don't. But it's great to seek that gift. Okay. Look at the third one. They will have divine protection. From who? It says, and I just want to share that a little bit, because they will be supernaturally protected from snakes and they will drink poison. What is Jesus saying here? Okay, and that's why actually I like the Passion Translation so much. I'm really enjoying it because it gives you an insight into the Aramaic behind what the Greek is writing. Because our New Testament is written in Greek, but Jesus spoke in Aramaic. And so the thinking behind this phrase is that it's referring to two Aramaic idioms. One is where snakes were seen as your enemies. And so protected from snakes is overcoming one's enemies. And poisonous words, poison was thought to be poisonous words of slander against somebody. And so dealing with attacks on one's character. And so what this would be saying is that you have divine protection from the enemy, which is of course the devil, but also the people he works through. The enemy's words, poison and deeds, what the snake is up to. So we will have supernatural divine protection, and finally we will heal the sick. As I said, not necessarily every believer all the time, but definitely the body together, and definitely it should be something that we say that I need to do this, I need to drive out demons, speak in tongues, I have divine protection, I heal the sick. We'll take the third one. Thank you God, I have divine protection. But it's the same, it's they will have divine protection. That same they will applies to they will heal the sick, they will drive out demons, they will speak in tongues. And let's be realistic, the gap between Jesus' words that they will or we will and what we see is huge. You know, I can't say the word huge anymore without thinking of Trump's huge. The difference is huge. But the point is this, will we believe his words that they will or we will, or will we believe our works or the lack of those works? I'm not seeing it, so it can't be true. Jesus said it. Is it true? Would Jesus give us authority but without power? And the challenge is this. As a church, can we persevere until every they will comes to pass? Or will we give up looking at the lack of the works and decide that Jesus didn't mean what he said, that they will? So from Matthew's version, we have that emphasis, or we we take from that presence, from Mark's last words, we take the word par, and then we come to Luke chapter 24, 46 to 49. Jesus said to them, "Everything that has happened fulfills what the scriptures prophesied of me. The Messiah was destined to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. Now you must go into all the nations and preach repentance and forgiveness of sins so that they will turn to me. Start right here in Jerusalem, for you are my witnesses and have seen for yourselves all that has transpired. I will send the fulfillment of the Father's promise to you, so stay here in the city until you are clothed with the mighty power of heaven." I just need Akshay in your Bible, just Isaiah 32 verse 15. Just find it and keep it ready for me, please. So what Luke is doing is elaborating on the content and results of our preaching the good news. Okay, what is the content? Repentance and forgiveness. What is the result? Conversion. In fact, that word for repentance in Aramaic would also mean conversion. You're preaching conversion and the results are conversions. Because really repentance is saying be converted. So they were to carry out their commission, as Matthew says, with his presence, as Mark says, with power. But first they needed to wait for the Father's promise to be fulfilled. And of course, we know they do that. They go to Jerusalem and they wait for 10 days. And at Pentecost, the promise is fulfilled. One word is repeated again in Luke's version, and that word is you. You must go into all nations and preach. It's our responsibility. You know, of late, I've been saying, and I've been talking to a few people, and we've been in agreement, which Jesus just came back now, just fed up of this world, fed up of what's happening, fed up of pandemics and lockdowns and politicians and all of that. Just wish Jesus would just come back. He said, you must go into all nations and preach. It's not done yet. It's our responsibility. He said, the second you are my witnesses and have seen for yourselves. What they had witnessed and what they had seen, they proclaimed. Which is why the early preaching was, Jesus is risen. That's what they saw and that's what they proclaimed. We all have our personal testimonies. What we have seen, what we have experienced, and we should be proclaiming. We are witnesses of lots of things. The third you is, I will send the Father's promise to you. Okay, we are all recipients of the Father's promise. We've all been promised that Holy Spirit. And the fourth you will be clothed with the mighty power of heaven. Okay. Just show me that Isaiah 32. You know, Isaiah 32 verse 15 says, till the Spirit is poured on us from on high, and the desert becomes a fertile field, and the fertile field seems like a forest. And we've prayed this so many times in the context of revival. Till the Spirit is poured on us from on high. And that's what Jesus is actually referencing here, because some of our versions say, stay in the city until you receive power from on high. It's the same phrase. Or this version, clothed with the mighty power of heaven. Something poured out on you from heaven, from on high. Okay. In fact, that phrase, no, until you are clothed, is not even something being put on us, but the sense is of sinking into a garment. This cloak or this garment of the Holy Spirit, and we sink and literally are absorbed until we are enveloped with the Holy Spirit. But even if you just take that sense of being clothed, walking around going to work, driving your car, walking on the road, being in the gym, or in Jairaj's case on the terrace, clothed with the Holy Spirit, clothed with power from on high, clothed with the mighty power of heaven. That is the promise. The third P, promise. You know, is the gap between what the Father promised and what we profess in our lives because of our lack of waiting, because He told them to wait. And is our lack of waiting a sign of unbelief in the promise? We've given up waiting. Or we've got disappointed and discouraged after a nice season, a dry season has happened. But let's again look at that Isaiah 32 verse 15. The desert will become a fertile field. The fertile field will seem like a forest. It starts with the Spirit being poured out from on high, and even before that, with us waiting. This waiting is not a one-time thing. They waited at Pentecost and the Spirit was poured out. It may be a daily time. It may be maybe seasonal time. Do we not wait because we've just lost faith? Finally, one word is found in all three versions of what Jesus says, Matthew, Mark and Luke. And that is the word go. Jesus doesn't tell us to go empty-handed, but He sends us with His presence, which is always with us. He sends us with His power to exercise the authority He has given us. And He sends us with His promised Holy Spirit. Again, I come to a bunch of questions. Will we believe? Will we wait? Will we receive? Will we go? Will we proclaim? Will we perform those miraculous signs? Will we disciple all nations? And yes, we've fallen short in probably every one of these areas. But even as we approach another Pentecost Sunday, let's make a fresh beginning this week in believing and taking Jesus at His word, and maybe through this week waiting upon Him for a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. Don't wait for Pentecost Sunday, for a fresh filling every day. Taking Him at His word and being so aware of His presence. Taking Him at His word and saying, yes, in Your name I do have the power and I will do these things and we will do them as a body. And believing His promise for a daily filling of the Holy Spirit. And we say, come Holy Spirit, seal these words as a good seed in our hearts, as good soil. And I pray, Lord, this week, as we move towards Pentecost Sunday, I pray for a hundredfold harvest of what You've sown in our hearts. I pray for fresh conviction. I pray for fresh passion. I pray, Lord, for a tangible sense of Your presence and an explosion of Your power through the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, Amen. And you know, the irony is, of course, this is that the one who tells us, I am with you always to the end of the age, all of the appointed days, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He chose to be left. He chose to be forsaken. He chose to be abandoned. Possibly the only time ever that anyone was God forsaken. And Jesus did that. Jesus chose that in order that none of us may be God forsaken, that He may truly say to us, I am with you always, all of your appointed days. He did that. He did that on the cross. He paid the price so that this supernatural power for miracle signs would be released through us. so that the resurrection would take place and the promised Holy Spirit would be sent to us. None of all that I've said today, none of all that He promised and that is true would have been possible without the God-forsakenness on the cross, without that price. And so as we celebrate communion, let's do so with thanksgiving, with that awareness. He did this for you and I, for our salvation, but also for the salvation of the nations, the responsibility for which He has given to you and I. For in the night that He was betrayed, Jesus took bread and He broke it. He gave it to His disciples, and he gave thanks and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is My body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And after supper He took the cup and He said, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood that I make with you and with many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." And so as we eat and we drink, we proclaim His death until He comes again. We also remember the responsibility that He's given us. We are thankful for the assurance of His presence. We believe that He has released His power in us. We lay hold of every promise, especially that of the Holy Spirit. And as we eat and drink, let's receive a fresh strength from His body and blood for the work that lies ahead. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Before we go into closing worship led by Pervin, we'll keep this time open for praise reports. I already shared a little about yesterday, but I think Rahil or Renel or somebody or Prema may like to share a praise report about Arts Collective. But of course, everything else that's happening in people's lives, just unmute and let's give glory to God.
Yes, I'm going to start. There's just so much to say thank you to God for. One, of course, is just healing me of this crazy past 3 weeks of COVID. But just want to say thank you beyond that, because during this time, He has been so good. A job my sister was looking for 3 days before her last job, like the last day of her previous job, she got a job. Wendell, who's been wanting to buy a bike for the past 5 years, his bike came last week. There was money that was supposed to come in last month, but did not, but came in this month just when we needed it. I'm just saying God's just been so good through this entire time. It's just want to say thank you, Jesus, for not just for healing and for protection, but for being so awesome, so sweet, so wonderful, and so indulgent during this time. Yeah.
All right, two things. You know, as you know, online teaching is pretty grueling. And I just wanted to thank God that every single day in this last week, He has given me the strength to do it. The kids have been great. We're all so exhausted. We can hardly stand it. And we have to go till June 11th. But, you know, the Lord just came through every single day. And then secondly, I would like to thank God for Supriya. And the way God is what's the word? It's astonishing, Supriya, how God has just given you this revived artistic ability. The WhatsApp stickers are just awesome. And I just think Supriya brings so much of God's creativity to our community. And I wanted to thank God for her today.
Woohoo!
Thank you, Carol. Actually, about those WhatsApp stickers, there's a huge praise report behind that, because I've been telling people that, you know, at the beginning of this week, I didn't even know how to make WhatsApp stickers. I never use them. Okay. And suddenly on, I think it was Wednesday, a request came in from my client, who's a retainer client. So basically, when the retainer client gives you a job, you can't even say no to them. Okay. You have to do it. So they said, do you know how to do WhatsApp stickers? And I said, no, I don't, but I can learn. And so it was on the heels of that project, that small project, that I quickly learned how to do it. And then we had Wednesday evening worship, and we did those declarations. And then Thursday morning, Pervin-led worship. And suddenly it was immediately after that, after worship on Thursday, it was like Holy Spirit tapping me on the shoulder and saying, you know, WhatsApp stickers plus declarations, you want to explore an idea there. And then it was just as though there was an explosion of grace, and it's not stopped, you know. And I'm just so grateful, because when I look back, it feels like God taught me how to make these WhatsApp stickers for other reasons also, but the sole purpose of just getting his word out there, getting encouragement to people. Because I recall at the beginning of this lockdown, before the lockdown happened, Anila and me were contemplating, you know, making little postcards with some of the worship artwork that was created, and having like encouraging verses that, you know, people could share with one another. But obviously, for very practical reasons, that's not been possible. And so it was just like Holy Spirit, you know, a new idea, you know. And it is God, because I would never have come up with this idea, because I don't even use this medium for anything, you know. So it was so God inspired and God breathed and God orchestrated, and really, you know, all of it was birthed in a space of even worship, because every one of those things has come out of that Wednesday time of declaration. And praise God for just the feedback. Lots of people are being blessed by it and encouraged by it. So I'm just so humbled and very grateful to God for calling me to partner with him in this. So yeah, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Highway.
Swapna has put in a praise report, and I'll just read it. It says, I would like to thank God for giving me a chance to read the Bible more. We had prayed for it once before, and this week I was regular to read it. And I just want to continue and just give thanks again. And I'm sorry, almost every week I'm coming back and thanking God for Thursday, but just cannot help but thank him, because again, we did a little time of just creating an open space. And honestly, I was telling Melissa that I'm absolutely terrified of just creating a space with nothing, not even some broad, simple structure. And we did 1.5 hours, and really at the end of 1.5 hours, we didn't even know where the time had gone. And the word that of sharing each other's burdens, I think, came alive this week. Because all that happened were people just sharing what they were going through. And as they were sharing what they were going through, it was so beautiful, because actually nobody said anything. There was no word, there was no nothing. It was just that each one found either solace or strength or courage or something new from what somebody else had shared. And I just had that picture literally of when God said sharing each other's burdens, it was literally us coming along, you know, we're coming with this huge thing which we think is only ours. And suddenly we come and discover, oh, so many others are also. And so suddenly it gets lighter, because we're all carrying that, you know. And we've got a new insight from something that has happened. So it was just such a beautiful picture of what God intended for us as a fellowship, to be able to come alongside each other and just share and draw strength and feel lighter. Yeah. So really, thank you, Jesus, only Him.
I want to praise God for yesterday. Thanking Jesus for two opportunities to be able to facilitate movement activation worship workshops. Actually, one was for a friend of mine who has a ministry called Call to Worship, and she does this every Saturday at like 6:30 a.m. in the morning and has a bunch of people from all over the world tune in. And she's been wanting me to get onto this thing and do a workshop since the time I was pregnant. But through everything, it was just like too much of a daunting task to get up at the crack of dawn and do it. And for those of you who know me, it's very difficult to be alive at that time. But I just prayed and I was like, God, I was dreading it, honestly. And I said, I don't know, you know, I'll be half asleep. But God just asked Him to order my day in such a way that, you know, I could be able to do that. And then in the evening, there was the Arts Collective worship night. And, you know, God is just so wonderful that in the midst of the whirlwind of all that's going on in my life, He is able to do this. So thank you, Jesus.
I just want to praise God for yesterday. It was so good to have Ranelle back in action and just see her move and facilitate that time. There was just such a huge burst of joy for both Ra and me seeing Ranelle facilitate that time and be like, yay, she's back. And she's back in like heavy duty motions, not, you know, small, dainty little things, full force, full power. So it was just such a blessing to be there for every session, and it was such a great time. And praise God for Ra, because the facilitation was so beautiful. It was just so cohesive and so such a amazing space to be in and receive all that God wanted to do. So yeah, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's some things in the chat. So one is Meher, who says, what do I say? A praise report, you say. Where do I start? My every breath is a praise. He gives me all I need, fulfills every need. So where can I start? Because every word is incomplete. When I start to praise God, all the time in my life will not be enough to thank Him for all that He has done. So I just say, thank you for being in my life. So beautiful, Meher. And this, Uday, you better be here for this one. This is from Jairaj. I asked Supriya to do some fun WhatsApp stickers. Oh Lord, not another breakout room. Jesus never says, hang on, I'm busy. Jesus never does typos. Soups, you're a superstar. She hasn't yet done them though.
Okay. Yeah, I'd like to, another praise report. Actually, I want to echo what you shared earlier over there during worship. It struck me too yesterday during that Arts Collective about what a tremendous influence God is using Highway as. And I really want to thank Him for the work that He's doing here. And the other thing I want to praise God for is just the freedom that this community offers, you know. Because I think so many other people are also so talented, so gifted, but they never get that opportunity to explore. And I really want to praise God for this atmosphere of freedom that people get invited into to discover the people God has created them to be. Just thank God for that, really. Because I think that's the space we discover and then we get to be that influence, which we can see, you know. Thank you.
Has anointed us to preach good news. because he has anointed us to preach good news. Spirit of the sovereign Lord is upon us, because he has anointed us to preach good news. Because he has anointed us to preach good news.
And the good news is this, that God so loved the world that he sent us his only son, that whomsoever should believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. And even in the midst of this just news of death that we see all around us, God, truly anoint us, Lord Jesus, afresh, with boldness, with love, with compassion, that we may just simply, Lord, tell the world how much you love them, so that each one, Lord, would not feel the fear of perishing but receive the hope of eternal life with you. Amen.
If you ask me to live out of my boat on the crashing waves, if you ask me to go preach to the lost world that Jesus saves, I'll go, but I cannot go alone, 'cause I know I'm nothing on my own. The power of Christ in me makes me strong, makes me
thank you. Misha has written something. I'll read it. How refreshing to know you don't need me. How amazing to find that you want me. Wow. God can do everything that has to be done just with His word. After all, He spoke the universe into existence. And yet, He chooses for us to be part of His great works, to be part of His kingdom purposes. How privileged we are.
When you ascend this day, just like you said you would, your word is not in vain, our hearts reaching heavenward. Fresh outpouring, gentle fabric open, come Jesus, come. Temporary phase.
Read out these. I put all these posters. I don't know if you can read the words, but I feel each of them is so prophetic, outpouring, manifest presence, signs and wonders, transformation, tangible presence, new life, more of you, dreams and visions. Come, Holy Spirit, light on a hill, let heaven invade earth, and let your glory fall.
I don't know if this is possible or not, but I just felt we have to do this, just the chorus and the fresh outpouring, and I, if possible, do it, you know, that flocking as a action, fresh outpouring, tear the practice, and everybody do it together with somebody leading us. Just
fresh outpouring. Tell the fabric open, come Jesus come, breath of heaven, nothing left unshaken, we long for more, we need a fresh outpouring, unleash a fresh outpouring.
Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, yes, Lord, all of us, Lord, need a fresh outpouring, Lord, of your Spirit, Lord. We need to be clothed, Lord, in you, through your Spirit, Lord. Today we pray, Lord, for each one of us, Lord, who is part of this church, who is part of not only this church, but of the body of Christ, Lord, that they will receive a fresh outpouring, Lord, of you, Lord. A fresh anointing, Lord, so that, Lord, you will enable us to go out, Lord, and preach to all people of all nations, all that you have taught us, Lord, all that that is in your word. We just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
That is the cry of our hearts. Holy Spirit, for more of you to be filled to overflowing, to delight in your presence, to release the rivers of living water, that our homes, our workplaces, our cities, our neighborhoods, our cities, our nation may be flooded with your presence. We cry out to you for outpouring. We thank you for touching us this morning. We thank you for the pleasure of your company and that you chose to take delight in our worship, in your worshipers. We pray through this week ahead, Lord, that we will be so aware of your presence, so filled with your power, and moving in your promises. We give you thanks and praise and say all honor and glory belong to you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.